Hello, welcome to Antioch Center for the Nations. We're going to get started now. It's exciting to be in the house of God. We had a good service this morning, the Chinese service. We had 19 people. Last week we had 15, 19. Let's just keep growing. So we're excited. We're encouraging them to evangelize and bring people in. And really the Lord showed me some things about that group. And I believe it's going to grow quickly. We're going to see some great things happen. And this is really what we want in Antioch, is multiple languages. And we're going to work toward that step by step. God is good. Kind to us, always faithful. Well, I wanted to have a little fun tonight in praise and revisit some songs from way back in the 80s, actually even late 70s, some of these. And so some of the older Christians will recognize these first few songs and we'll have fun with them. But we're here to praise the Lord. We're here to lift Him up and give Him glory. Amen. How many of you want to praise Jesus with me? Why don't you stand to your feet? Thank you, Jesus. We love the Lord. Amen. The Bible says, blow the trumpet in Zion. Amen. Blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm of my holy mountain. Blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm. Rush on the scene.
Ah! Sing it again.
You're the one.
Holy
come to Jesus. Thank you for your great love.
Come true, that seems true.
bright and morning star. Thank you for shining your light on us tonight. Have your way in this room, Lord. Do whatever you want to do in us. We're hungry, hungry to see your new and exciting things from your spirit. Our hearts are open. We're longing to touch you and be touched by you. We're thankful that your presence moves through this place like a river. Let your wind blow through this, your temple. Let your wind blow. Touch and fill everyone here today. This place is yours. We yield entirely to you. Thank you for your presence. And thank you for being here with us today. Open our hearts. Open our minds to receive. Thank you, Lord. Would you find yourself into your seat? Make yourselves comfortable. We had a great time Thursday night. Those who came, the presence of the Lord was strong. He's here tonight with us. What I like about the Lord is you never know what a meeting's going to be. We can plan, we can strategize, we can make a strategy. We never know. We yield to the Lord. He knows better. Defer to Him, to the ebb and flow of the Spirit. That's exactly what it's like. God's presence comes and goes, flows in, flows out. Maybe you know what an undertow is. It's not a toe under your bed or something. But it's like if you've ever been swimming in the ocean and the wave is coming in and the water pulls out and comes. I talk about the ebb and flow, that's what I'm talking about. God's Spirit will come, you'll feel a drawing forth. You feel the undertow of heaven. I think it has something to do with His glory. His glory is real, it's not something we make up or imagine, but it has effects in the physical world. His glory touches and changes, and so kind of as it's approaching, as He's moving, it'll create a vacuum. Inhaling of our air. And in that moment that He does that, He's sucking away all the impurities. He's pulling out. He's breathing by first, breathing in everything that is dark about us, everything that is wrong about us, everything that is our problems and our depressions. He just draws it off of us. That's what that undertow does. And I feel the Lord just pulling, He purifies us in His presence, and His presence is fullness of joy. Treasures forevermore. He does that, He cleanses and He purifies, prepares His own room for Himself inside of us, and He comes, and He fills that temple. See the Lord high and lifted up. His train fills the temple of each and every one of us. Don't you know you're the temple of the living God? Jesus is so patient with us. He's so kind. He gives us so much time to adapt and learn and grow. He's always kind. I pray that the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be upon you tonight. Throughout your everyday, from the time you wake to the time you go to bed, pray that you would be inundated with the presence of the King. I pray that you would be keenly aware of Him at all times, your daily affairs, your job, everywhere you go with everyone that you speak. I pray that the presence of the Lord would be real. as we allow it to be in our life. We step away from doubt, we step away from disbelief, we meditate, and we come in and we give God time to prove himself. We be still to know that he is God. We do that by faith and understanding, and indeed you will never be disappointed. God does not disappoint. Anyone that calls on him will experience, will know his fullness. There's no one person that deserves more the presence of God. All are equal, so therefore it's up to you, it's up to me to make sure that we get all that God has for all of us. So Lord, we don't want to ever shrink back. We want to constantly push him forward into the presence of the King. Holy Spirit, do great and wonderful things. Lead us and guide us. We trust you, Jesus. We trust you tonight. Speak to our hearts from your word. We learn about dreaming, what it means to be a dreamer, how important it is. And all those in the word of God who were dreamers, who dared to dream. Help us to learn and grow. You are the one that makes dreams come true, but those dreams first have to be dreamt. People have to imagine the greatness of God and what he can do through us. So Lord, challenge us tonight with your word. We open our hearts to you. We open our minds to you. The message tonight is a dreamer's gonna dream. I mean, if you've ever heard, you know, the joke around saying, "Haters gonna hate." You know, people full of hate, they're gonna hate. But a dreamer is gonna dream. When somebody is a dreamer, that's what they do. They dream. I mean, if you know someone, you think that guy is like a dreamer, or that she's so dreamy minded. Always he or she's always thinking and picturing and dreaming, and some people can criticize this. In fact, I've been criticized my whole Christian life for being a dreamer. And early on as a young Christian, when I got saved at the age of 17, received Jesus as my Savior, the Lord put me into certain environments. Of course, he sculpted my beginning. Very carefully, I've shared many testimonies about how he lined me up in the right place at the right time to bring me to mentors. I've had 7 major mentors and then other teachers along the way. I've been on an assembly line, especially the first 7 to 8 years. I was handed from teacher to teacher to teacher. They would give me everything, and I was so voracious, and so my appetite for the Spirit was so great that I consumed a lot, so I would wear mentors out very quickly. They would be happy to pass me on to the next teacher. And so I went through them, all in good relationships. I have great relationships with all of these people still, the ones that are alive, because about a third of them have actually passed on. And so these things I've learned and grown through the years. And early on, I was in a meeting where a minister preached, and he preached a message about sowing into another man's dream. And it was the story of Joseph, and how Joseph spent his life working in and depositing into the lives of other people for the longest time before anything was ever a benefit to him. And technically, nothing ever became a real benefit to him, because everything was about saving the world. And so we see him as a type, a figure of that. We know the story of Joseph. We know the end. Almost all believers know the story of Joseph, maybe even have seen cartoons, or you've read it yourself, and you know that eventually he saves the whole world from starving to death because of the interpretation of dreams. And those dreams that he hears from Pharaoh, he's able to interpret and express, and we know what goes from there one step after the other. But I want to go tonight to the source of what led that man on that path. I heard messages about this when I was 17 years old, and it put in me, in essence, the anointing to dream. That I began to dream and imagine and think of things, And from my standpoint, because of my my background, we didn't have much money. I was very poor. I come from a background where there was nothing to do but just sit on the sidewalk, and there was not. We weren't involved in anything, and so we were bored. And people who are bored sometimes have a tendency to dream even more. So that helped, and that again also is the Lord working all things together for the good of those, right? So He's been making me that. I've been a dreamer a lot, but I've been criticized for being a dreamer. But I want you to understand some things about dreams. Dreams are like faith, and this is because dreaming requires you to think beyond what is presently before you. So that's also faith, isn't it? Faith is seen like dreaming. Dreaming equals faith to me. Because dreaming is picturing and believing something in the realm of fantasy. We can play and pretend. Children have fantastic minds. They have whole worlds in their head. I can hear my children play, and they have a whole plot and storyline and mental storyboard about whatever the G.I. Joe is doing or whatever's happening, and that's a beautiful thing. And the reason children are so creative and are such dreamers is because no one has yet told them not to dream. And so they have dreams unleashed. The ability to dream and imagine and conjecture and think about what could be more than where they are, it's without limits. But I found in life that everybody is born as a dreamer, but life itself and the mechanism of people around them has the potential and almost the design to take dreams away, to reduce the ability of dreaming, to say that having that kind of imagination and that being a dreamer, marking it as wrong and saying that that's not productive or you need to concentrate on this. And it's true, children need to concentrate on their studies, they need to do things, but you better leave room for your children to dream. Let your children play, for God's sakes. Let them have fun. I've always been an advocate of them playing and having fun and enjoying and imagining. It's a very good thing, because where that imagination comes from is the fact that God has given to every man a measure of faith. Faith is the ability, it's the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things unseen. So it is that those children who are playing and imagining and dreaming, it's a real world to them. So much so that if you go in there and knock over their little blocks, they will burst into tears because you just destroyed their world. I had an entire community of villagers living under a bush in front of my house. It was this mossy stuff that grew under this one bush we had that looked like grass. So it was perfect. It looked like a grass field with a big oak tree over it. The bush was about that high. And I literally had to lay on my belly to play with my army men under there. And there was a whole universe under there. We had what we call doodle bugs. You ever see those little bugs that roll up in a ball? There's roly-polies, there's different names and different. We had those. Well, those, compared to my army men, those were massive enemy tanks because they would run through the grass. And my whole world revolved around that. And I remember one day my brother, who always wanted to do evil things to me, it was pretty much his call in life. He went in there, and with his feet, he just tore up all my moss, the grass, and stepped on my bugs, and burnt with cigarette lighters my army men and melted their heads off. And you know, brothers are good for it. They do stuff like this. But it devastated me. Devastated. I saw when dreams were shattered, like my world was hurt. But anyway, this is all one of some of the reasons why we also learn not to dream is because we were hurt by a dream or hope being deferred that made the heart sick. We had an expectation, an idea, but don't let anything stop you from dreaming. And that's faith. Let your faith be alive. Dreams are like that. Dreams can come true for those who believe. I love this quote. If you can dream it, you can do it. Walt Disney. Walt Disney had, before theme parks existed, this man decided he was going to create a world. He said, I'm going to make my own world. Well, what do you mean, Mr. Disney? I'm going to make Disney World. First, it was Disneyland. But when he made Disneyland in California, he already had the plans and the ideas for Disney World. And he envisioned the whole world. And he also envisioned before that productions and cartoons and things that we know Disney is very famous to this day. Now they've actually bought the Star Wars franchise. And all of that is from one man who was famous for saying that if you can dream it, you can do it. Because he decided to let his dreams become realities, and it happened for him. Well, what was he doing? He had faith. He spoke things that were not as if they were. He spoke and confessed his vision about an amusement park, about a theme park called Disneyland and Disney World. And as of today, if there's nothing I can tell you to prepare you for Disney World in Orlando, Florida. There's no way you can understand it unless you actually go there and see it. It's absolutely amazing. It is incredible. I've been several times and I'm due to go again soon, as soon as I can get back. It's an amazing experience. So dreams are like God's breadcrumb trail for you to follow. People who are not dreamers will not follow. Realizing your destiny requires dreaming. And the simple question, are you a dreamer? Maybe as I've been introducing this message, you've remembered or had thoughts back on when you were taught not to dream, or maybe that you shouldn't dream. But I want you to be a dreamer. I would recommend that you be a dreamer. Dream. Dream. Imagine. Think. I still to this day dream. I'm almost 50 years old. I have Star Wars Legos all over one wall. My bedroom is two IKEA shelves covered with Star Wars Legos. You guys know this already. You know, still to this day, I play with those things. I will pick up my X-Wing fighter, and I don't just pick it up, I make the noises. And I still play with my toys. So why would you do that? Well, I know the Bible says that we can't even enter the kingdom of God unless we be like a little child. Why? Because children dream. And to enter the kingdom of God, you need to believe in dreams. You need to believe in things that you cannot see or feel or touch or experience in a natural realm as if it were already real. Believing in heaven. What proof do you have of heaven? But we believe we're going. And we're excited about it. We dream about it. Are you a dreamer? You should be. So in this message, we will look at Joseph as the most famous dreamer in the Bible. And we can learn from his experience. We're going to see seven things about a dreamer. In fact, we're only going to see the beginning of Joseph's life. Because as I started looking into it, this message only spans from his first dreams. We will not even really touch on the fulfillment of them because our focus tonight is the dream stage. So that we be able to dream, that we have an imagination and an idea. Before we go on, I want to pray. Lord, I know without a doubt that you anoint us to dream. That you give us the same ability that you have. Because by faith, the worlds were framed and brought together. That means without even having existed, you thought them up and you spoke them into reality. You dreamt them up. Your dreams made us. And you have made us in your image and your likeness, which means we are supposed to be dreamers. We should be dreaming dreams. Lord, the same anointing that came upon me years ago, I pray that it would come upon us all tonight to push us into a realm of dreams, imagination, and ideas, especially concerning your kingdom and all that we have to achieve with this limited time that we have here on earth. I ask this, Lord, in Jesus' name. If you agree, say amen. Amen. Seven things about a dreamer. Number one, dreamers are born from destiny. Genesis chapter 37, verse 1. Jacob lived in the land where his father had stayed, the land of Canaan. This is the account of Jacob's family line. Joseph, and right away, as he gives an account of his family line, it goes straight to the youngest of the brothers, Joseph. Or Joseph and Benjamin, they're one of the youngest of the brothers. But why did it say, this is the account of Jacob's family line, and start with Reuben or Judah or one of the other brothers? It immediately goes to Joseph because the Bible at this point is going to entirely turn to focus on Joseph and his life. Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brothers, the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. Remember, Joseph was a child of Rachel. Rachel is no longer alive at this point because she passed on and she was buried. And now his father, Jacob, who is Israel, has kept Joseph as his son, and he was working with and tending the flocks with his brothers, the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives, and he brought their father a bad report about them. And this means that they were doing something that was not proper or correct. And obviously, because Joseph cared about the estate of his father and the well-being of his belongings, he mentioned what was being done wrong. But dreamers are born from destiny. We see here that Joseph's father, Jacob, was a dreamer. Genesis 28:12 said he had a dream. This is speaking of Jacob years before, in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending. It's one of the most famous dreams in the Bible. Jacob's ladder is referred to. He saw the stairway to heaven come down because he dreamt this, he imagined it, and then he chose to believe his dreams. He chose to believe what God was showing him. And this is the thing, a lot of the thoughts that you have that you think that you're imagining are in fact God's voice. Because God put it inside of you. He puts that idea in you. Some people think they just have an active imagination, but the activity of that imagining is often God-inspired. God puts it in you. Very often I have random thoughts that I think are random thoughts, but it turns out they're not random at all, but rather systemic to the utterances of God or what God is telling me about my future. It would be easy for me to disregard them and decide that I need to stop thinking so much. And that would be me submitting to people in the past that have told me, you need to stop being a dreamer. You're just a dreamer. My own pastor told me that at the age of 17. I told everybody I was going to Mexico. I told everybody I was going to the nations, that I was going to go preach the gospel around the world. And almost all of them rolled their eyes when I would tell them, I'm going to the nations. I'm going to preach the gospel. And they go, oh, yeah, right. How about you get a job first? How about you get an education? Because I had no education. I had no job. In the very beginning, I was poor, off the streets. My clothes were old and had holes in my blue jeans before it was the style to have holes in your blue jeans. And I didn't have anything. And so I was the poorest kid in the church. I was that benevolent case. You know, the church is always the benevolent case, the kind of smelly person that sits in the corner and everybody's too nice to. Hi, how are you? Because everybody, they're loving them. And I was that guy. I was the guy in the church that everybody paid the special attention to, pat me on the head. And so anything I said, especially when it comes to my conjecturing about the future, my dreams, it would be met with disdain, be met with anger sometimes. And I was called a dreamer. I mean, nobody really believed in my vision. There was one or two people that I'll get to in a minute I'm going to talk about, but in the beginning, no, not even my pastor believed. And I was branded by him. He said, don't listen to Stephen. He's just a dreamer. When he said that, of course, it hurt, but the Holy Spirit spoke to me and immediately said, so is Joseph. And I realized I was in good company. Me and Joseph were dreamers. And so at 17, I decided I'm going to dream anyway. I won't do it in an offensive way. I won't arrogantly dream. I'll try my best. But it just so turned out that a lot of my dreams were like the same dreams that Joseph had. He was 17 too, by the way. That's how old I was when I first got saved. But now we see Joseph's father, Jacob, was a dreamer. Jacob's father, Isaac, was a dreamer. Isaac's father, Abraham, was a dreamer. Look back in the history. Joseph came from a lineage of dreamers. It was his destiny to dream. All of his family, his father, his grandfather, his great-grandfather, were dreamers. They imagined things that could not be seen. They labored for and worked towards something invisible, all based upon what God told them about a promise of what they would be. They had to envision it. If we're not dreamers, we will not be in line with our forefathers. Being a dreamer is how we walk in our destiny. And this point about Joseph, of course, is that Joseph, the dreamers, are born from destiny. And I believe that everyone is destined to become something wonderful. And you are from a lineage of dreamers. If you're any way subject to what I teach and what I preach or the anointing in my ministry, well, you're in trouble because it's a dream ministry. So from me will come. If I lay hands on you and pray, you're going to have dreams. Now, it's your choice to do what you want with those dreams. Discard them, ignore them, or begin to walk in them. But I follow the dreams that the Lord gives me. I follow the imagination and the ideas that He gives me. And I'm glad for it. I like what the Father has given me. I like what the Lord has done in me. And if we're not dreamers, we're not going to be in line with all that God has in our forefathers and His destiny for us. Number two, dreamers are anointed. Genesis 37, verse 3. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other sons because he had been born to him in his old age. And he made an ornate robe for him. When his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. And you're going to find out that through this relationship that he was destined to be a dreamer and he was under the mentor, which was his father, that blessing and that favor was on him because of it. This robe, all of these elements of him being a dreamer. So Jacob loved Joseph above the others for many reasons. His father favored him. He made a special robe just for him that distinguished him from those around him. And he was consecrated by favor. That the father's favor was on him and it caused him to be more blessed than the others. But why did he love him more? Well, that's a good question. One of the reasons is because he was the product of his beloved Rachel. And Rachel was now dead and gone. And the other wives did bring him children. They were part of the overall inheritance. But Rachel was the one he truly loved. He loved Rachel so much he worked first 7 years and then was deceived by giving given the wrong wife. But then after that, he worked another 7 years. So he worked 14 years for Rachel. How many of you men have labored 14 years to get your wife? I didn't. I got it in 6 months. 6 months from Barbara walking in the door and me looking at her, love at first sight, mouth hanging open, watching her. 6 months from that day, we were married. And so, not 14 years. And this does not mean that I don't love my wife. I love her with all my heart. I would die for her right now. But the point is that he loved Rachel. And Rachel gave him a child, children. And now Rachel's gone. That's one of the reasons why the favor was there. The love relationship was there. But he made this robe for him. And the robe is symbolic of the anointing or favor of the Father on us. In fact, you know, the anointing on us, the robe we wear, the covering that is on us, that is God's favor. In fact, the anointing is grace, because grace is unmerited favor. And He clothes you with grace. He clothes you, you're clothed in Christ, which is God's favor, unmerited, undeserved. But He puts it on you, and that's supernatural abilities and authority and things. All that we call the anointing is on us. Jacob loved it. Number three, dreamers dream. That's what they do. Joseph had a dream. When he told it to his brothers, they hated him all the more. By the way, these are very hateful people. Because we studied this once before. It was so funny because they incrementally hate him. First they hate him, then they hate him all the more, and then they hate him even more. Like, the hate just keeps increasing. And I'm going to explain that in a minute, but let's go through the passage. And when he told it to his brothers, they hated him all the more. So he had a dream, and he tells them. He said to them, listen to this dream I had. He's all excited about it. Hey guys, I had a dream. You want to hear about it? It's awesome. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the field when suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed down to it. His brothers said to him, do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us? And they hated him all the more because of his dream and what he had said. That is interesting to note. They hated him because of the dream, but also that he spoke the dream. Then he had another dream. If it's not bad enough already, Another dream, because dreamers dream. They just keep dreaming. They can't stop dreaming. They can't help it. And he told it to his brothers. Now, you think he would have learned his lesson from the first dream having been told to the brothers that caused them to hate him. But this is the thing about a dreamer. A dreamer, he can't help. He's like a drug addict. He's got to speak the dream. He's got to say what he's seeing. And this is one of the reasons why dreamers are irritating. This is why I can understand early in my church why I was so irritating. Because I was speaking such big things from a perspective of being a nothing and a nobody. And I'm going on and on about what I was going to do for God and where I was going to go. And I'm going to go to the nations. And they were like, you know, you might want to get shoes before you do anything. Or how about you? I mean, they were very critical. But I was dreaming all the time. He said, I had another dream. And this time the sun and moon and 11 stars were bowing down to me. When he told his father, as well as his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, what is this dream you had? Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down to the ground before you? His brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the matter in mind. But still, his father was not happy about the dream. I said a moment ago, my pastor was my spiritual father, same thing. I had dreams, but he was very cautious about them. And because he's the one that would listen to me, and my pastor was very kind. He was a pastor. Pastors have the ability to listen to us even when they don't want to listen to us. It was always, so I took that as he was in favor of it, and that he was excited about it. It wasn't until that moment when I heard him tell someone else when he didn't know I was there. Stephen's just a dreamer. So I can identify with this. Didn't understand, well, will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down the ground before you? His brothers were jealous of him. But his father kept the matter in mind, as did my pastor. He listened, he didn't dismiss it. He just did his best to help me through it. And it wasn't until later, you know, with hindsight, it's easy. Everybody, now all of them, oh yeah, Stephen was called of God, one of the most anointed men we ever met. It was obvious from the beginning that the Lord's hand was on him, raising it. No, they did not see it that way. Dreamers dream. That's what they do. They can't help it. They dream. 28 times of the 64 times that the Hebrew word for dream appears in the Bible are found in the story of Joseph. Like half the times almost that dream is mentioned, it's Joseph and surrounding Joseph. Joseph and everything around him was all about dreams and dreaming. His whole life was built and driven by dreams. When we open ourselves up to God, and the destiny that he has for us, we will become dreamers that dream, because dreamers are going to dream. That's what they do. And I'm a dreamer, so I will always dream. If you sit down long enough and talk to me, this is so funny. I go back to the United States. I talk to Pastor Butch sometimes. I start telling him about what we want to do, what we're seeing. He says, man, it's all this stuff you're telling me. It's like giving me a headache. He said, that's just so much administration you're talking about. I said, I don't look at administration. I look at thousands of missionaries. And you know, I like dreaming about what we're going to do for the Lord. But he sees the hard, practical. And we're fighting our way through the administration. We're going to do everything right. And we're going to do it polished and perfect. And I'm glad that God has given us wisdom and people to help with that. But I'm going to dream. I'm going to always dream. And we're going to keep dreaming. If you don't like dreams, you're in the wrong church. Because this is a dreamy church. And we're going to dream about great things. Why? Because dreams can come true. And if you can dream it, you can do it. I agree with Walt Disney. You will see a day in the future that things will be very different. You'll remember, hey, remember when we were. You say, well, how do you know that? Because I've seen it from country to country. I go back now and have those conversations from stuff I did in the 1990s. And we and all the pastors sit around, hey, remember when we first started? And I'm in 7 churches, 2 Bible schools, the biggest problem is how to air condition the upstairs offices, and I'm helping them how to do that. And this is the way that things develop and grow. And I was there when it was a tarp over a stick and a rope. And that's when we were saying it will be there. And I was speaking it then what it is today, the Ministry of Mexico. So what I speak about today is coming from dreams, but I guarantee you that the dreams will come true. So whether you like it or not, dreamers are going to dream. Now, there's problems that come with this. Number 4, dreamers have adversaries. Actually, more accurately, this should say dreams have adversaries. Let me explain what I mean. Now, his brothers had gone to graze their father's flocks near Shechem, And Israel said to Joseph, as you know, your brothers are grazing the flocks near Shechem. Come, I'm going to send you to them. Very well, he replied. So he said to him, go and see if all is well with your brothers and with the flocks and bring word back to me. So he's like his little spy. He's a little punk, he sent out there to tell on his brothers. Then he sent him off from the valley of Hebron. When Joseph arrived at Shechem, a man found him wandering around in the fields and asked him, what are you looking for? He replied, I'm looking for my brothers. Can you tell me where they're grazing the flock, their flocks? Now, let me tell you something about dreamers. They have a tendency to wander around in fields. Now, I'm going to be honest. But at least they're in motion. At least they're doing what the Father said. The Father's commissioned them and sent them. They really don't always even have all the resources or the ability to know what they're doing or how they're doing it, but they're doing it, and they will wander around in the field for a while until God sends somebody and say, hey, what are you doing? I'm looking for my brothers. Because they at least are in motion. God loves people that are doing something, that are active, versus people who never do anything. And are always. I'm gonna paste a link to something I saw on Facebook. I'll put it on my timeline if you want to go see it. There's a game show host in America who makes this speech about everybody has to junk. He talks about people who make it and are great. What's the Harvey Keitel? So Harvey something. He does Family Feud. It's an old television thing in the States, but he's very popular in the United States. Steve Harvey. That's it. Steve Harvey, he's a black comedian, an African-American comedian. And they recorded him before his television, one of the biggest television shows in America. Before it was on, you could see the prop masters in the back setting things up for the television production. And he's talking to the audience. It's one of the best messages I've ever heard. 6 minutes only. Powerful. And he talks about dreaming also. I'll have to, if I had it, I'd play it for you. But I'll put the link if you want to really listen to something powerful. Now, you're going to watch it and say, that he's a preacher. He's not a preacher. You'd swear he was a preacher when you hear it, though, but he's African-American. A lot of them just sound like preachers no matter what they say. So I heard him say, he says, what are you looking for? He replied, I'm looking for my brothers. Can you tell me where they're grazing their flocks? They have moved on from here, the man answered. I heard them say, let's go to Dothan. So Joseph went after his brothers and found them near Dothan. Now you know that the man didn't tell him, he would have still been in that field. But they saw him in the distance. And before he reached them, they plotted to kill him. That's a big step from just hating him. Here comes that dreamer. They're calling him the dreamer. Here comes that dreamer, they said to each other. Come now, let's kill him and throw him into one of these cisterns and say that a ferocious animal devoured him. Then we'll see what comes of his dreams. Dreams. Dreams will get you in trouble. The enemy fears the dream, not the dreamer. But this is the thing about it. The dream itself was the whole problem for Joseph. Yet the whole solution for saving of the world. The dream that was leading him on was a vision of a future where he would be in a place to bring salvation to the whole known world and keep them from starving to death. And God's plan was to save the world. But the dream was just a part of that. The dream is dangerous. The dreamer is just a component of that. The dream embedded in Joseph was the remedy for the impending catastrophe at hand. But he didn't know that. And dreamers really are just incidental to the overall process of the dream master who puts the dreams inside of people. And the dreams are packaged in dreamers and taken. But the enemy is less concerned with the dreamer than he is with the dream itself. And if you hide a dream, because you notice every time he had a dream, what did he do with it? He spoke it out. You hide a dream, there will be no opposition, there'll be no problems, you'll be safe. Keep it inside. You have dreams and ideas, great. Put them inside and they will never be born, they will never come out, and you will never walk in God's destiny for your life. But also, your boat will always be calm and you will be able to rest and have peace and live in a comfortable place. And to me, that I'm describing hell to you. That's hell to me. Living in a comfortable place where everything is okay. No, I like the edge. I like I like nail-biting things. Who likes a movie where you go watch the movie and it's very predictable, you know exactly what's going to happen? And you know, how many of you are bored with movies like that? You're like, duh, of course he was going to do that, and boring movies. And I like the nail-biting cliffhangers. I like exciting movies when you never know what's coming up. So life is like that for dreamers because of the dream. We as dreamers carry the solutions for the souls of men. Without our dreams being conveyed and delivered to the realms of reality, the people will suffer. Because all of us are called as a servant to people. Therefore, the dream is the gift of God sent via courier to save the nations. We, the dreamers, are the couriers. If faith is equal to dreams, as I said earlier, dreaming equals faith or believing, think about the scripture that says that we're saved not by works, but by grace, and that by faith, and that is not of ourselves, it's the gift of God, but it is delivered through the word preached. This is how it comes. The dream is faith. A dream has to be spoken. People have to come in line with the dream. People are not as interested in a dreamer as it is the dreams that they speak. It's like being fascinated in a prophet that doesn't prophesy. This guy's a great prophet. Oh, really? Did he prophesy to you? No, he's never prophesied. Well, how is he a prophet? It is according to the action of the individual. A dreamer dreams. A dreamer speaks the dreams. That's how you know he's a dreamer. And those dreams become true. Saul speaks of faith. Number five, we only have a few more. Dreamers have advocates. Now, this is just like dreamers have adversaries. Dreamers also have advocates. At this point, the brothers have decided to kill him. They plotted to kill him because they hate the dream, because they said it. Now let's see what comes of his dreams if we kill him. But really, the target wasn't so much him as it was his dreams that enraged them, because the enemy hates your dreams, but we have advocates. When Reuben heard this, he tried to rescue him from their hands. Let's not take his life, he said. Don't shed any blood. Throw him into the cistern here in the wilderness, but don't lay a hand on him. Reuben said this to rescue him from them and take him back to his father. So Reuben cared enough to protect him. Reuben also did not like the dream. I'm sure Reuben was just as offended, but something in Reuben's heart told Reuben to watch out for Joseph and protect him. And that was God stirring him to keep. I had a Reuben in my early church. His name was Mike Caminita. He was a rather short man who's actually, he come from a family of horse jockeys because they were diminutive in their size. And so if you ever met jockeys, horse jockeys, they're shorter people. Small frames, because it's easier for a smaller person to ride on the horse. There's less drag of weight. And his brothers were jockeys. And this was a cool little guy, and big in heart, though, and very intelligent. And he spoke so clearly. And when I told him that I wanted to be a missionary, what I was going to do, he was excited about it. He was my Reuben. When everyone else was against, he'd say, "Don't listen to them, man. I believe in your dreams. Tell me more." And he would sit me down and want to hear more. Whether he was interested in it or not, he stimulated the dream. Because he knew it was important. And you know, it's funny, I saw him not long ago and recounted to him all the things that I've done in the last years. And he said, "I always knew that." And he did. He's the only one. I said, "That's right, you did. And you stood with me. You were my advocate. Kept me safe." So the dreamer's brother rescued him from death. The dream was kept alive inside of the dreamer. The dreamer is the jar and the dream is the treasure. Says that we have this treasure in earthen vessels and jars of clay. The dream is the treasure. That's the idea. It's the task, the thing. And because what he was seeing, his dreams were connected to his function on planet Earth, his call, what he had to do for God, his job. The dream is the voice of God. So God, knowing that the dream is of the utmost importance, empowers and motivates people around us to help the dreamer in his or her time of difficulty. When we walk in the dreams, or in the realms of these dreams, we have advocates from the Father, because He wants to be sure that that dream is delivered. Now we go to the next, number six. Dreamers walk on unpredicted paths. Now this is a recurring theme again and again and again. You've heard me preach this idea. We don't know the path. So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the ornate robe he was wearing. They took him and threw him into the cistern. The cistern was empty. There was no water in it. As they sat down to eat their meal, they looked up and saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead. Their camels were loaded with spices, balm, and myrrh, and they were on their way to take them down to Egypt. To where? To Egypt. And all this now is coming together because God has a vision and a design, and he knows for him to do what he needs to do, he needs to get his dreamer to a certain place, and that's Egypt. Judah said to his brothers, "What will we gain if we kill our brother and cover up his blood? Come, let's sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him. After all, he is our brother." They're having a little bit of remorse about what they wanted to do. "Our own flesh and blood." His brothers agreed. So when the Midianite merchants came by, his brothers pulled Joseph up out of the cistern and sold him for 20 shekels of silver to the Ishmaelites, who took him to Egypt. Which, by the way, reminds me, there are like 60 or 70 similarities to the life of Joseph and the life of Jesus. This is just one of them. Remember what Jesus was betrayed for? 20 shekels of silver. His whole life, Joseph's whole life is a prophecy of Jesus' life. And I went through a teaching one time that identified. It's really uncanny when you go through all of them. When Reuben returned to the cistern and saw that Joseph was not there, he tore his clothes. He went back to his brothers and said, "The boy isn't there. Where can I turn now?" Then they got Joseph's robe, slaughtered a goat, and dipped the robe in the blood. And they took the ornate robe back to their father and said, "We found this. Examine it to see whether it is your son's robe." He recognized it and said, "It is my son's robe. Some ferocious animal has devoured him. Joseph has surely been torn to pieces." Then Jacob tore his clothes, put on sackcloth, and mourned for his son many days. All his sons and daughters came to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. "No," he said, "I will continue to mourn until I join my son in the grave." So his father wept for him. At this point, and at almost all times, on the journey toward the fulfillment of his destiny, Joseph had no choice concerning the course of his life. And this is what I mean by unpredicted paths. His dreams had led him down an unpredicted path. A series of events, seemingly negative and random, were in fact the exact plan of God. How else would he have been able to do what he did later in Egypt if he hadn't been put in Egypt? How would he have ever been put in Egypt? And what was the best way for him to go? When we live by the dreams that God gives us, we yield to his plan and purpose as we surrender our wills in deference to God's wisdom. So we trust him with our lives and futures. This leads us down the same unpredictable path. I can't predict. I would have never been able to predict all the things that have led me into where I am today. Just like you can't either. If you can predict the path to get to the destination, then it's probably not God's path for you. Now, the destination, yes, he will show you. Sometime back, remember the Spirit of the Lord spoke very strongly, prophetically, in a meeting we did last year sometime. And the word was, and I'm going to put it in just a few, because it was a very long prophetic word, but God said that, you know, he's the same, he doesn't change. His design for your life, that is his destiny for you, it is irrevocable. And it will never change, and it's set for you, but the path to that destiny changes daily. And he spoke about this principle, the Spirit spoke, and said that you will never, it's unpredictable. You never know what it's going to take for you to get there. You just know, I'm supposed to go there, but we walk in God's direction. God's going to work it all out for you. He'll take care of it. Leads us down the same unpredictable path, especially if you're going after your dreams like Joseph. And we end with this: God uses dreamers. Meanwhile, the Midianites sold Joseph in Egypt to Potiphar, one of Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guard. Notice, think of the random series of events, all seemingly negative, that have led Joseph to be in the home of someone in the court of Pharaoh himself. How many people do you think were there that could have bought him as a slave instead of these people? But God was in control of everything. We fast forward Genesis 50:19. But Joseph said to them, he's speaking to his brothers, and this is after everything. After the dreams are interpreted, after he has multiplied the grain, he's kept it, and the whole world is being saved because he incrementally is giving grain out for the survival of the nations. Joseph said to his brothers, don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it, the harm and the pain, for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. You say, well, if you think Joseph saw this as a painful process? Yeah. So much so that when he had his children, he named them according to the fact that they helped him to forget the misery that he lived through. The path can be miserable. The path can be horrible. And I'm telling you about dreams, and this is why a lot of people don't dream and don't speak their dreams, is because a dream will draw persecution. A dream will put you on the path that God put you on, but that path will not always be easy. But it'll make you into what you need to be if you submit to the process. And you too can be in a place and see that God intended all that you go through for good to accomplish what will be done, the saving of many lives. So knowing the entire story of how Joseph was implemented as a tool to save the world, we see his understanding at the end of God's plan. The fullness of this understanding did not come to him until his destiny was accomplished. It wasn't until that moment that he stood there and finally his brothers did come that he realized, oh, this is what it all came down to. And that's how it is with the Lord. God uses those who dare to dream and live by their dreams in pursuit of their destiny. They may not comprehend the entirety of that destiny until it is finally realized. Seven things about a dreamer. This is what we saw. Number one, dreamers are born from destiny. And I tell you tonight, you are born from destiny. There is a purpose to your life. There is a specific purpose that God has for you. And the only way you're going to connect to it is being able to be a dreamer like Joseph. Dreamers are anointed. God's favor is on you. If you yield to it, you serve your Father in heaven, He will make a special robe for you. He will put His anointing on you. And of course, the more you serve Him and bow in deference to Him, those around you may hate you for it. But keep dreaming, because dreamers dream. That's what we do. Number four, dreamers have adversaries. There's going to be people that rise up as enemies against your dreams. Try to keep in mind that it's really, they're not coming against you as much as they're coming against God's factor of you. And it makes it a little more bearable. Even Jesus understood that when he said, Father, forgive them, they know not what they do. Because he knew that he was just caught in the middle of the devil wanting to destroy the greatest dream of all. And the Father had a dream that all would be saved, and he sent his Son to realize it and fulfill it. And that was not a fun path for him to walk, for it all to happen. Dreamers have advocates. Reuben saved his life. If you dare to dream, you're going to get in trouble, but there will always be people that help you through it. Number six, dreamers walk on unpredicted paths. Now, we can't predict. We know that he's going to take us. You can trust that it will be fulfilled. Tarry and wait for it. And though it tarry, it will be fulfilled. The Bible says that it might take some time, but God will do what God said he was going to do always. Number seven, God uses dreamers. If you want God to use you, then dream dreams. Be open to dream. Tell God, I want to be a dreamer. I want to think. I want to give this. See, dreams are also creativity. I'm believing that God is going to raise a lot of amazing ministries out of this nation. I'm believing part of my vision is to see Singaporeans and all the nations of the world planting and raising amazing ministries. And you say, well, I don't know. And it's so funny because there are many reasons why that's difficult in this nation for this very idea. Because in this country, I have found that dreams are looked down upon often. that this more of serious, stoic mentality about education and plan, this is what needs to be done. There's no room for dreams. So I've got my work cut out for me here. But I've already managed to infect quite a few Singaporeans. And they are already pursuing their dreams, doing things because they've dared to think. Now, they've faced opposition, usually from their own parents and family and those around them, but they're continuing the dream. And we're going to see great and wonderful things. Later down the road, those around you that criticize you are going to turn around and benefit from it, like Joseph's brothers. Their lives were saved as a result. Then you'll see, your day will come, they'll be like, oh, we always knew you were destined to do great things. And you'll be like, don't be vindictive. Just say, oh, thank you.